Hi, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the next session. My name is Martin, and it's a pleasure for me to moderate the next session, which is called Virtual Stages. And in this session, we will learn how we can use immersive technologies such as VR, MR, AR in different contexts, right? So in animation, in movies, in games, in storytelling, and also in hybrid work, right, at the end. At the intersection between reality and virtuality. And before we start with the first speaker, let me briefly explain the procedure. So we will have the talks, and after each talk, we will have a Q&A session. For asking questions, you just need to raise your hand, and the runner will bring the mic, okay? That's it, basically. And now, let me introduce the first speaker. She is a digital artist and architect and experimental filmmaker. She graduated with distinction at the Academy of Fine Arts Vienna and is also the holder of the Marianne von Willemer Prize 2020 for digital media. And her work is strongly influenced by alternative ways of society and transgression, as well as new forms of artistic and architectural production using modern technologies. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rebecca Merlic.
Hello. Hi. Great that so many people came. And I will just, today I will present you Glitch Bodies, a project which is very dear to my heart and which was also awarded as an honorary mention at this year's Ars Electronica. And I want to show you glimpses of behind the scenes and production phases, which is usually not really shown in exhibitions or in short movies. And I will also tell you a little bit about my artistic research. So as digital progress penetrates every aspect of our lives, it becomes imperative to explore and comprehend the potential effects of this convergence of reality and digitality. My work seeks to explore the realm of artistic research and the development of XR realities and game engines in order to understand the ways in which these fields shape and influence this fusion. In particularly, we will delve in the concepts of world building and gamification adapted to my multi-platform project, Glitch Bodies. Recently inspired by Maria Lugones' definition of world traveling as a means to counter of digital structures that perpetuate the rise of populist movements in our society. Impressed by the rapid progress of digital technologies and their implementation and artistic creation, I would like to investigate aspects with you today of co-creativity and inclusive processes in my art. See if this works. So Glitch Bodies is a multi-platform project that consists of a visual novel game, a VR experience, an animation movie, and a performance piece. The inclusive project portrays more than 59 protagonists. I started in Vienna, then I went to Munich, Hamburg, Berlin, Zagreb, Bangkok, Tokyo, and London. So, and all these protagonists co-created a Glitch Bodies verse, let's say it like this, with me. So we created this through collaborations and rituals, and Glitch Bodies explores new forms of feminism, LGBTQ+, drag transformations, and intimate, sensitive representation of the protagonists, and aims to bring them to a wider audience. And this is why it's a multi-platform project, because if you want to... Also, even gaming is very exclusive. VR is maybe more inclusive, exclusive. So for me, it was very funny because the project was funded by the film Abteilung from the Ministry of Culture. And then they knew that I would like to produce a game, but they gave me the money, and so I had to produce a short movie, and I never produced a short movie before. So it was very funny for me, kind of, how I funded this project. And then I learned a lot, and I worked with the Film Academy in Vienna to actually learn how to create a movie. And also, like, costs, like camera equipment, we didn't have because it was a game and I used digital cameras in Unity. So it was a little bit different than normal film production. But for me, then I thought, how can we expand this? Not only the short movie, which was screened at ORF 3 on Saturday morning, so grandmas and grandpas saw the movie, because I think nobody's watching ORF 3 at 9 on a Saturday. And so it was very interesting for me, okay, let's explore different different outputs. And then I met all these wonderful protagonists and we created the Glitch Bodies game show, which I will talk about it later. And who is Glitch Bodies? So everybody who shares queerness as a political movement can join Glitch Bodies. And for now, it's 59 protagonists. This is a group pick, but it's not like all. It's just, I don't even have a complete overview. And it's divided into 16 game scenes. Some protagonists share a game scene, and others have demanded their own private space. And the division, even if it's a collective work, sometimes division is also needed because the protagonists wanted like a digital representation, which was then more of a singular way of showing them. And I want to show you a short trailer because maybe you didn't see the animation movie.
Dripping silver, dripping gold, dripping silver, dripping gold, dripping silver, dripping gold, dripping silver, dripping gold.
This was a short introduction. So who is Glitch Bodies? For now, it's 59 protagonists and a team of three people. It's me, a sound designer Manuel Riegler, and Unity programmer Vivian Schreiber, as well as VR programmer Anna Rüth. So it's a very small team, but a lot of protagonists. So maybe about the production, for me, co-creativity was very important. And I think a lot of projects claim these kind of words or phrases. But from the beginning on, I try to do a co-creative inclusive process. And how can new technologies and co-creative inclusive production processes blur the boundaries between digitality and virtuality and reality? I think it's like about communication with the protagonists. So I will talk about this process later. Then the second question would be, how can performers be represented in digital safer space and then be brought back to the analog world to generate a new audiovisual act of performance? And what does it mean to provide a safer platform for non-heteronormative gender positions, sharing the notion of queer as a political attitude, providing new perspective for the player, for you, while celebrating its protagonists with motherly care? This is also very interesting. I never released the game, so it's not, I could release it on Steam, But since the internet is not a safer space, I decided to just show it in exhibition purposes or on performances where the protagonists are also safe from comments or from, it's not always the case, unfortunately, but releasing it to Steam and to the internet society would not provide the safer space, what I wanted to do with glitch bodies. I use world building as a gamification method for narrating different realities. So we have the 16 game scenes, and every protagonist wrote with me a kind of a form, or we had a contract how the digital representation would take place. And it was very vague because all the protagonists don't come from digital architecture, they don't come from game design, so they didn't know how a game works or how is it produced. But in workshops, I kind of introduced my tools to them, and so they could decide how their representation would look. And in the end, everybody was surprised because, of course, they had something in their head, and I couldn't read the head. So, but luckily, I have to say, all of the 59 protagonists are very happy with their digital representation. So the process, as I mentioned before, we started in Vienna during lockdown. I talked to Alexandro Cosaca, who's the initiator of the Wer ist Dichter Collective. And I just pitched him the idea, and then he proposed 10 protagonists, and this is how we started. Then we did the writing workshops or the contracting, where there was a form where the protagonists could decide about scale. So scale in the meaning of how big is the player towards the digital 3D scan. Can you enter the person digitally, or are you blocked? Is it one-on-one? But all the protagonists wanted to be bigger than the actual player. What soundscape do you want? What atmospheres? What special effects, which was not always easy to make, and so on. And then we had the 3D scanning sessions, also starting in Vienna during lockdown, so some illegal pictures. We met at the Academy of Fine Arts and did some 3D scanning illegally, because luckily some of the protagonists are still students there, so we could enter the building. It was very hard to kind of work and all the testing, as you know. And yeah, this was like 2.5 years ago. That was the first session. And here you see protagonists from the Wer ist Dichter Collective, Chica Chicago, Susie Flowers, Danielle Pump, which is an amazing painter, Annemarie Arzberger, which does art with costumes. And then I went to Bangkok. Also, it was kind of lockdown. I think the third lockdown. It was also hard to kind of enter Thailand, but somehow I managed with the help of the Austrian Cultural Forum, thankfully. And then I met with New Peace, which I first met during a night out 2016 in my first visit to Bangkok. And I contacted him and asked if he would know some artists in Bangkok who would be keen on becoming a glitch body. And then we collaborated with 11 artists from Bangkok. This is the 3D scanning session in a hotel room in Chinatown. and also the same procedure. It was also a little bit difficult because of language barriers, of course, also translating the contract and the form into Thai language, because some of the protagonists couldn't speak English and my Thai is very bad. But we somehow managed, also without speaking the same language, which is, I think, art can do. After finishing the project in June 2022, I did some performances in Vienna as a tryout, but I really wanted to go back to Bangkok, where I also had the initial idea many years ago, and also bring back a platform for the artists, because some of the artists from Bangkok, for example, are marginalized. They don't get as much funding from the government as I do sometimes. And so I wanted to go back to Bangkok, but didn't have a clue how and who would finance it, actually. So I made a new project, a research project for a new film, which I probably never will make. It's about shopping malls. It's an interesting topic, but I got a stipend in order to go there and actually to work again with this artist, because it was not possible with Austrian funds to pay Thai artists. So I found a club called The Commune. It's kind of a techno club, and they never did art performances there, but they had a 15-meter wide LED wall, which is kind of a fetish of mine. I really want to work with LED modules, but it's always very expensive. So the club had the equipment. I contacted them, and we met in person, and then they, of course, they gave the space for free, but I need to make like a proper club night. So they demanded that I would find my own, that I would book my own kind of party. So there was a after the performance, there was a DJ lineup. I didn't know any DJs in Bangkok, so I went out a couple of weekends before, kind of scouting who would want to play at the Commune after the performance. And I was very happy that also the Bangkok artists came and contributed with their performances. So this was kind of the setup. The photographer and the videographer canceled last minute. So this is the documentation of the event is not so good. But as you can see, I'm playing the game live on stage. The sound designer Manuel Riegler is also generating the sound live. And from a digital library we created together. And for example, Morgan is live on stage. And to come back to Vienna, my first Glitch Bodies game show was in the context of experimental game cultures, the Ludic Soiree, organized by Margarete Jahrmann. And it was very funny because we didn't rehearse at all. I just invited the Viennese artists to participate, and nobody had time to rehearse. So we did it like on the spot. And it turned out to be an opera piece, because it was in the end 2.5 hours. So the visitors were really nice. They didn't leave, and nobody complained that it was boring. So this was a different setup, but also the same principle. I would play the game, and the protagonists would do their performances in their outfits from the Glitch Body scans on stage. And I also have a short trailer of this performance. But maybe I load it a little bit, because the internet is kind of not so good. As you can see, I mean, it's sometimes it's a song is played, or sometimes it's a drag performance or voguing. Particularly also at Die Angewandte, I had the luck that one Bangkok artist was invited to Mainz, so I just invited him to come to Vienna, and I just had to pay the ticket from Mainz to Vienna, which is not so expensive as to fly them over from Bangkok. And it was a very diverse presentation, and I also wanted to play all the game scenes. This is why it took so long, also without protagonists on stage. So maybe now we can. I can show you the trailer.
Yeah, ich will der Mann. Lass mich Auto fahren. Yeah, ich bin ein Mann. Lass mich Auto fahren. Yeah, ich bin ein Mann. Lass mich Auto fahren. Es ist alles, was ich kann. Ich bin ein Mann. Ich kann mich nicht verfahren. Ich geb die Richtung an. Seit 3000 Jahren. Seit 3000 Jahren. ist echt, wie spät ist es, mein Packticket. Ich darf nie Gefühle zeigen, außer beim Zwiebelschneiden. So viel Druck, Explosion. Diesel nicht, Benzin schon. Ich steig aus, ich steig aus. Ich verkauf's, ich verkauf's. Ich bin die Norm. Ich geh Erdelborn. Weiblichkeit nur wenn konform. Schieb den Sitz auf Form. Führerschein verloren. Schlüssel steckt, Schlüssel steckt. Abgeschleppt. Yeah, ich bin ein Mann. Lass mich Auto fahren. Yeah, ich bin ein Mann. Lass mich Auto fahren. Es ist alles, was ich kann. Yeah, ich bin ein Mann. Es ist alles, was ich kann.
Yeah, this was Vienna. Then performance I want to show you very quickly because the time is short. It was at Tanzquartier, Museumsquartier in Vienna, and Lisa Holzinger saw the Bangkok performance, so she invited me, she asked me if I would do this in Vienna at Tanzquartier at this year's Spit Festival, and I asked all the queer Viennese-based protagonists to produce a different kind of game show. It's always different because the content and the performances are always different. And I think it was a great success also because the Tanzquartier is the place where you can really produce great performances. The equipment, the technicians, the funding is great. So we had a lot of fun producing this. And yeah, how it's going. It's never ending, so new game scenes will develop, and maybe after Ars Electronica, there's Berlin Art Week. There is a new version of Glitch Bodies exhibited. It's an AR, VR, and the game layering, as you can see in this Instagram post from a person who visited it yesterday. And it was a new form of how an exhibition can layer all the multi-platform outputs in one space. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Rebecca, for this interesting talk. Now we can start the Q&A sessions. Do you have any questions? Are there any questions from the audience? Yeah, let's start here in this third row.
Very interesting, but we haven't seen a live game excerpt, but I would like to know what the customization is about. So how do you customize each session when you say you have a performance and then you can customize it to another place or the characters? So the individual customization is interesting.
Yes, it's always different. Now in Berlin, next week I will have a performance and I invited the Berlin protagonist to participate and they never performed with me. So then for this performance, then I just show the game scenes of the Berlin and Hamburg protagonists. So it's always different because of the 16 game scenes. It's really huge. I tried to show it in deep space in 20 minutes and I was very rushing and I maybe showed like 7 game scenes. So I think it's always different because I return to the places where I had collaborators and protagonists and then we work on a different Glitch Bodies game show. So it's always the game, of course, but always in a different angle. And it's free for the performing protagonists what they want to perform. So if they want to do a reading, if they want to play a song, if they want to mimic a song. For example, at Tanzquartier, Annemarie Arzberger wanted to lip sync a great song from Peter Maffay, and I was okay. I was like, okay, this is like maybe a little bit weird in the combination with the game, but it also worked. So it's always different, I would say, and it's always it's a never-ending process because game scenes will, I will work on more game scenes. People reach out who want to participate, so it will be like a growing archive. I don't like the term archive, it's maybe a little bit negative, it's something from the past, but like a growing digital archive of representation. And as soon as I get more funding, I will, because it's, for me, it's also very important that everybody is paid, even if the person doesn't even want to, they just don't want to be part of it, but so I'm always saying that they have to wait, unfortunately, and still there's new funding.
Great. Are there any other questions from the audience? Yeah, we have a question over here in the front row.
That's an amazing project in general. And I watched the movie downstairs, and you mentioned that. Yeah, I just wanted to ask about like the characters and locations and surroundings. They were, because it's like really dynamic how you're like transported from one location to another one. And I was wondering, like, is it also connected to their stories, or they had a request where they want to be, or with what setting they want to be surrounded with?
Yeah, yeah, so I mean, this is for the contract I told before. So they had had their vision, but they didn't know how it will look in the end. But for example, I don't know, Versdichter wanted a train station with a subway, walking through a subway, entering a library, and then entering a bar where all the protagonists would sit and chat. And it should be gloomy, 80s vibe, foggy situation, as I remember. And so they had their ideas of which soundscape they could imagine or which architectures. But then in the end, it was, of course, my freedom to design it. And all the assets are made by me. There's this one asset I bought from a Ukrainian 3D artist because I really liked it and I wanted to support. And all the materials and the glitch body shaders are programmed. So it's all, I mean, I think this is the art behind, if you imagine, is it really an artwork? But I think if you put effort in the assets and of course the shaders, shader programming, it becomes also something like a paint, as a painter would have mixed their own paint. And I think there's a lot of artists who buy assets, which is also fine if the concept is strong. But I think it's then it's difficult to judge than where, I mean, maybe it's a very detailed, drifted. But yeah, I think this is how we worked. And I think I couldn't imagine the whole Glitch Bodies verse alone and just put them. It would be not really how I imagined the process to be. I mean, this is what I want. This is what I mean with co-creativity and collaboration in terms of requests. Actually, they requested how it should look like, and then sometimes it looked totally different, but they, but some elements were made, and they were very happy.
And it was mostly developed in Unity?
Yeah. It's
and with LiDAR scans from the phone, or you use
no,
another
No, it's a
technology?
Handheld scanner. Ah. It's kind of, yeah, I don't want to mention the...
Okay, yeah.
No, I mean, I don't want to make a... They didn't sponsor it, so. but it's a handheld scanner. But I also used my phone. We did 360 recordings with a Zoom, photographs, videos, artworks from the protagonists, sounds from the songs. As you heard, Click Click, for example, contributed a song. Or also Tony Renaissance, maybe you know Lost Islands. And then... I was free to create these worlds, but it was always in communication and with approval. A scene now?
Into a Unity scene?
Seven minutes, I think we can do it.
How long do you think does it take? So I can quickly include the questions?
Yeah.
Or do you have to focus? I know, that was pretty quick.
Yeah. I don't know how to do this. So there's like multiple, you can hold. So there's like multiple scenes. They sometimes have one protagonist, like in Ariban, or like whole collective. So what I mentioned before, wer ist Dichter? So we enter the subway. And you can see this is the subway train. And then you have like sounds, but also it's interactive. Maybe a little louder. You have narrations from the people itself. So there's a lot of interactive things. And as you can see, I'm walking through the library as requested. And then there's the bar where all the where the whole collective is sitting, and they also have their own scenes, but here they're together. And for example, here we have some pictures of the process of the 3D scanning, and also artworks by the photographer Sarah Tauber. And yeah, and then you exit. So each scene is kind of, you have to find a portal to go into the scene and to go out. Yeah, it's very diverse, I would say. Anna-Marie Arzberger is just her in the scene. And this is the monastery, the Ukrainian, I mentioned before. I mean, I dismantled it a little bit to suit the game scene, but and this is more atmospheric, and you can just walk around and look around. It has no interactive element, because also Anna-Marie didn't want it, since she's working, she's using costumes as art form. So it was, the focus was on the costume. Yeah. I don't know. Time is up, or I don't know how it's.
Okay, great, Rebecca. Thank you so much for this quick demo. Yeah, we we have a next question.
Does it work? Ah, no, it works. Thanks for the presentation and this demo. You mentioned you don't want to release your game-related projects on Steam because the Steam is not a safe space. First, my thought, maybe performance art institutions or clubs, for example, may also not be safe spaces if you, you know, it can happen. And we heard a talk about this in the morning. And as a second, or maybe now as a question, isn't there other options to maybe confront a gaming scene that is maybe sometimes dysfunctional, or however you may call it, you know, to confront a game scene with something that is maybe new for them or different for them?
No, I think it's definitely in the future, but I just didn't have actually the time, and also I wanted to give it a good thought. But for example, Steam, I mean, now the Serpentine game from Gabriel Massan is released on Steam. It's actually a little bit hard because it's not really optimized. So my computer almost exploded when I tried to play it. So which bodies, thanks to Vivian Schreiber, is not the case. But even the comments section, I think, of course, clubs are not safer spaces, but I think we have to... We can make it like this. I can choose it. I can choose it, and the commune and Bangkok art scene or club scene is very safe for queer. I mean, it's like the commune was a safer space for everyone. So I think I wouldn't go and just release it in any club. Or, but I think art, I mean, galleries, exhibitions, of course. Yesterday I was confronted by some issues from the audience in Berlin seeing this project. But of course, there's just comments. But I think the internet, yeah, it's just, it's a different culture of being mean and, yeah.
I understand.
But I think I want to release it. But of course, there's also the thought maybe there's some institution or foundation who would like to show it permanently or collect it, of course. One edition of it, because it's too dear, I think, for all the protagonists to give it away.
I think I totally understand when you talk about Steam. Yeah. Hopefully there's other platforms or whatever that are maybe hopefully more open and have a different audience or target group.
Yeah, or maybe something analog. I mean, to just sell it on an SD card, I don't know. So if you buy it, then, you know, just the comment section would be... Without a comment section, it would be more safe, I would say. Yeah.
Great. So thanks so much for the interesting discussion. Also, a big round of applause for Rebecca once again. Thank you so much for this great talk. Thank you. And now, I think we can come to the next speakers. Lucy Hammond and Dirk Neldner. While you were setting up everything, I will quickly introduce both. So Lucy is projects producer at Pilot Theatre in the UK, and her work is focused on immersive technology and interactive storytelling. She was shortlisted for Content Creator at the Arts Council England Digital Cultural Awards 2023, and she's passionate about supporting young people and those who would like to enter creative industries. And Dirk has worked as cultural manager for various theaters and organizations. He has developed and directed numerous large international collaborative projects that challenge traditional theater narrative using immersive and modern technology. Okay, so Lucy and Dirk, the stage is yours.
Thank you, and nice to be here. We are presenting today a theater network. All in all, we are 21 organizations, 9 European theaters. Each of the theaters is related with a tech local university. And we have 2 major digital advisors. That is the University in York and the Akademie für Theater und Digitalität in Dortmund, Germany. And as we do here, we are using 3 conventions, Republika in Germany, Ars Electronica here, and we had in mind also to use York Mediale, but unfortunately, Corona came and stopped it. It's, as you see, a very broad platform that are all traditional theaters. Most of them have an own permanent ensemble and performing in repertoire, so not ensuite. And there it is a challenge to bring digital arts into it and to merge both digitality and theater. And that's what we want to do, and therefore we got 5 years, one more year than we applied due to Corona. And today we want to present you some of the work the network did. And when we started, we agreed on that we are following 3 steps. In the first step, theaters want to learn new storytelling. And as a partner, each theater chose game developers so that we were using game structures in ordinary theater productions. On a second level, we continue with that, what they learned in storytelling, and we added the use of any kind of immersive technology the theater could choose. And the last step, and most of the theaters are right now producing for last level, is to take both new storytelling, interactive storytelling, immersive technology, and bringing it outside into the urban space. Last little general information is that the theaters are asked to work on a content which is less a dystopia. We want to tell and share with our audience concrete utopias, hope, and to use technology in a positive way to think about how future could look like in a best case. That is a reference to a German philosopher, Ernst Bloch, and his principle of hope. Each of these steps is related to a production, and there you can see our timeline, and you will see that we are now in the season 23-24, where we will produce the last production. And now I'm giving to Lucy, and Lucy will introduce you to one of the production with a game structure.
Thank you, Dirk. I'm going to talk a little bit about how the theatre companies through this process began approaching using game structures, but also perhaps tentatively starting to use technologies that were familiar to their audiences in their storytelling. And the first example is actually really interesting because it's a project that I have worked on in a different format. It's a project called Traitor, which actually began life as an immersive experience by Pilot Theatre, where a group of young people broke into a school after dark and on a sort of whistleblowing mission to follow a hacker who'd stolen some files. The piece then got adapted into a virtual reality escape room experience, which I directed, and it's now been adapted by this company, Calibri Theatre. I will say that both our theatre companies, Pilot and Calibri, are focused on engaging young audiences with their work, so bear that in mind. And we'll show you a short video now with Vido, the artistic director of the piece, explaining how they adapted this project for their audiences using decision-making technology.
Originally, we wanted to make a production about an imagined war in Europe, but after February 2022, when Russia attacked Ukraine, we dropped this topic. In order to save all our technical preparation, we decided to go back to one of our earlier plans from years ago, The Traitor, by Esther Richardson and Cecilia Lunsholt, which is about the dilemma of the growing surveillance technology. In our version of The Traitor, the audience member arrived in a small theater venue. Everyone has a mobile phone set up with an application in front of them, and through that they can interact live with the story.
The production uses a custom mobile application that communicates with the dashboard and database in the cloud. So this allows us to control the devices in real time during the show, but also allows for international cooperation live in real time from here in England to there in Hungary.
Through this complex application, the audience member become participants of the production by making choices about the storyline and helping the main character to make the final decision, which is who she should give the pen drive, the stolen pen drive with sensitive information, to her mother, who wants to observe everyone for 24/7, or to obscure civilian organization which wants excessive freedom. The other challenge was how to create dramaturgically and technically the storyline with several branches and sub-branches following the spectators' very decisions. Probably that was the biggest challenge for the actors too. I mean, to learn different variations of some scenes.
The biggest challenge in this work is changing how I think. As a game designer, I mostly think about players engaging individually with a game. So seeing how deeply theatre makers think about their audience as a collective has been really fascinating for me.
Hello? Hello. So that was Ben Kerman there and Vito, who worked on Traitor. And what was interesting about the choice to use decision making, an app, was a really interesting introductory technology that several of the companies in the network decided to sort of toy with and explore. Another company in Krakow in Poland used a similar decision making technology, but the audience members used their own phones, and it was an adaptation of 1984 by George Orwell. So this is fascinating in a sense that this was the first foray for a lot of these companies into trying to use technology in their productions. But they all very much still made a play. They very much had actors on stage telling a narrative, and they were just exploring a very small part using very familiar technology to all of us in the sense of an app and a phone. There have been other productions, however, that have taken the storytelling outside of the auditorium and into different spaces. One of those is Dirk's project, which I'm going to pass over for him to talk about now, Berlin at Play.
Yeah, and that was done with Landesbühne Sachsen, Platypus Theater in Berlin, and with the support of the Akademie für Theater und Digitalität. And now we first will see a little video. Berlin at Play is bringing theater into the virtual space.
Now get acquainted with the tablet in your hand.
Congratulations. You have made the right decision in joining in on our project. Now the game can begin.
The user explores the city with a tablet in his hand. He's guided with GPS.
Follow me with your tablet's camera.
And at certain points, he can scan the environment with the tablet and see the scenes.
It was crazy the way that this other digital world was just imposed on the real world. And seeing the dancers, the virtual dancers in the real park, and buying a real coffee with virtual coins.
Your CAF coin balance is shown here.
Can you make CAF coins at the time? Yeah.
Leave the cafe and follow the marker. It's
quite an interesting experience.
You're almost there.
It was a great experience walking around the area I lived in as a kid and seeing this whole area from a different perspective.
The area that we were in was a totally new area for me in Berlin, and you got so sucked into the world. Like, it was super interesting to see it in a new light.
Oh. The best moment for me was the humor in it. I really loved the wit, and I loved to experience augmented reality.
The technology being used, the idea behind it, I think is brilliant.
And as Lucy said, here we tried to bring a story into the urban space. The story we followed is after Franz Kafka, The Castle. And for those who remember that, that's a place where Karl, the main character, never arrived. And for us, we used it in a metaphoric sense, the data clouds, where we are always sending data, but we will never be able to arrive there to get our data back. And that's why the people here collected coins and answers more and more stupid questions. The challenges for us in the production were the communication between those who were who did the programming and the artists, two different worlds and languages. Mainly understandable as an example for you is the word creativity. So when the artist wanted to get more space and freedom and create something and wait till they could be creative on the next level. The developers already said, no, that's already done, and we don't want to touch this again. And so that was a bit complicated. It's a tourable show. So we already performed it in, I think, more than 10 different cities. But we expected to have that change from one city to the other far more easy than it is at the end. It always takes another 2 days to implement it into a new city. And we had some troubles with tracking and GPS. So that is mainly with augmented reality, and you did a show with virtual reality.
Yes, so I'll show you a short trailer, then I'll talk about the project. This is the project I creative produced and directed for Pilot.
We are shaped by the spaces that made us. We are monoliths. Strong, upright, clever and brave. Our voices forged by the wild up north.
Cool, so we've completely departed the theatre at this point, and we're in a virtual reality headset for this experience. So this idea actually originated from a series of live performances that were created during the pandemic with women writers from the north of England, some of whom had never written before, others were professional poets, and they performed their work outdoors with the soundscape of the landscape around them sort of augmenting their performance at the time. And this really inspired me. I thought, how incredible that this sort of these difficult circumstances have allowed us to create a kind of lightning in a bottle kind of atmosphere where the soundscapes of the cities, the countryside where they were performing, we did it in several locations, became as much a part of the performance as the women's voices themselves. And so I managed to gain funding for this via an R&D fund. And much like Glitch Bodies, it was a very small team. So it was me, one developer, the three writers, a sound designer, and a composer. And then I started working with the writers to commission three pieces about their identity and the landscape. So the whole piece is about 12 minutes long, and you visit three different landscapes that are sort of a magic realist version of places in the north of England, one of which is a bus, and lots of sort of incongruous and strange things happen while you're listening to their voice. The poet is disembodied in this case, so it's very much about the human voice and the landscape. So this was my second virtual reality piece that I've made for Pilot Theatre, and this by far has had the widest reach. It's been seen so far by 5,000 people. And Pilot are a touring company, so we're really interested in trying to find new ways of engaging our audiences that are easily tourable. And this has enabled us through film festivals so far to go to Australia. It's been showcased in America, in Germany, in Hungary, and it's continuing to be shown, so it's going to be shown in France next month. And that's an incredible opportunity for us. We also, off the back of this, which is a version that needs to be tethered to a laptop, managed to gain funding to convert it to standalone on a Quest 2 headset. And it's now part of a national showcasing program in the UK. So we've managed to amplify the reach of what was a tiny project originally, shown to a maximum of 30 people outdoors, into a global project seen by thousands of people. And so this is a whole learning curve for us. And I think the biggest thing to say, really, the biggest challenge is ensuring that we can maintain building new projects with this type of funding. It's becoming a little bit more scarce now, and theatre budgets, the kind of funding that we get as a theatre company, wouldn't necessarily cover this kind of work. I have to always seek external funding to make these things happen. But I think it was a real learning curve as well for some of the cohorts who came to see it when we were at Republica in Berlin. And there was a lot of debate about, is this theatre? And I think that's a continuing debate, but in my mind it is, because it is essentially using theatrical techniques of how to guide your gaze. You're in a 360 environment, and it's also really focusing on the quality of the human voice as part of the experience. So, yeah, that's a little bit about monoliths. And these, I'll show you this. So this is the magic realist environment of the seaside. And so the moon, for instance, an example of the animation is that the weather changes sometimes, animals appear, incongruous objects, you saw that door appear. We also used really unusual techniques, which I was really interested in using real film. So in the bus, there is real footage of a bus journey through Bradford that is played outside of the build of the bus, which is the next one, yeah. And words from the poem appear in the mist on the windows, other forms of animation happen. And in the moors especially, it's all about the weather. So you're there at sunrise and very quickly the whole sky changes and blazes orange. So I think that's the final slide.
Okay, that are of course only some sparks of all the productions are done already and will be done in our project. And a huge part of our program is training. Because, as I said at the beginning, that are all traditional theater companies, and there's a lack in their ensembles for people who have that knowledge, the skills to produce digital arts within a theater. That's why we have the two already mentioned partners in Dortmund and in York. They give us permanent workshops and training opportunities and also the knowledge to exchange with other people. And due to Corona, we invented an online conference. We called it HOPE. And we already had two issues in 21 and 22. And in a couple of days, beginning of October, we want to have our third edition in Dortmund, this time a hybrid version. So we will meet in real in Dortmund, but also will put it into the internet so that audience worldwide can follow us on HOPE. And a last example of a production, Lucy.
We're going to go back into the theater now for an amazing production by Elsinore Company in Italy called Frankenstein, Teatro Elsinore. And this was actually an incredible example of the coming together of lots of thinking that had come about during a lot of the kind of the CPD training of the companies during this whole process. And this is a good example. It's a one-woman show, but is it? the audience wears headphones, and so they utilise binaural sound, which was attuned to the auditorium in which it was performed. And then you can see the figure in the projected video there. They created this amazing technique with the projection screen and HD video where the performer was sort of choreographed to interact with the video and vice versa, which also played in with the binaural sound. And so it felt like a really celebratory coming together of a lot of the thinking whilst really retaining its theatricality by maintaining a kind of auditorium style setup, which a lot of these theatres are having to play with. So this is another example of how you really felt like the other character on stage was really there, really beautifully staged. I think there's one more example. Yeah. So, and as the performance goes on, that the performance is actually about Mary Shelley and Mary Wollstonecraft, her mother, the projection screen itself becomes deconstructed. So at the end, we are just left with the stage. I just wanted to give that as an example of where we are with this intersection. I feel like it's a really nice way of showing how far some companies have come from very traditional staging to this.
And you, most of the companies are doing these kind of exchange and platform work since many years. We are following, in a way, that audience which was born at the millennium. And we had several theater projects to follow them. And that's why we are here in at the Ars Electronica again with that age group. Now they are in the early 20s, and we are producing with them at the Ars an interactive audio walk, and with a robot, with of course audio and performing. And we will present that after the Ars Electronica when the schools are back in Linz on Monday and Tuesday, and that's a little reminder for that. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for this talk. So let's start the Q&A session. We have a question here in the third row.
The landscape piece with the voiceover, it was most interesting when you just said you managed to open the game to a group of 30 people or bigger audiences without using headsets. So I would like to know more about the possibility to share the experience in the same space with VR.
Well, we actually haven't done that yet. What we've done is untether the experience. So you used to have to it used to have to run with computers attached to the headsets. But now it's part of a showcasing program where 30 people can sit in an auditorium in headsets and it can be triggered at the same time.
So they all have the same headsets are synchronized?
Yeah, synchronized, okay. Yeah.
Not projected or something?
No, but I have actually, I don't know if you've seen Outernet Global or Lightbox in London, the huge LED screens.
Yeah,
I think that this piece would be, I'm really excited about maybe trying to find funding to explore looking at having it in one of those 360 LED spaces, because it would work just as well as the VR headset in that space.
But then you always address the question with the protagonist, who is leading the experience? So that was my question. If you have a shared common space in VR, so who is leading, who is deciding?
Well, I suppose every individual in the room looking in which direction they choose.
So no, that's a really interesting question. So that's something.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So we have a question here in the front row.
Thank you for your presentation and showing this diverse works. I have a question to the VR piece also. How do you deal with motion sickness? Like, how long is the piece? And usually, maybe the age, the theater public is different and different age, and how do they experience it? Or
so it's actually a seated experience, and I didn't have an image of it on this slide, but we have a built set, and you sit in a very comfortable chair, and you do not fly around the environment. You remain rooted in your spot. You can have 6 degrees of freedom in terms of seating, but I was very clear that I didn't want anyone to feel sick, and to this day, no one has felt sick. Touch wood, there's always
you cannot
time.
Move.
Yeah, so you can't fly around. Yeah. I was determined that that was unnecessary. Objects do appear in your hand, but there's no other controls. And I've shown it from 13 years old until a woman who was 90 years old saw it. It was designed to be incredibly accessible for people.
Oh, sorry, we have a question in the back. Yes.
Yes, thanks for the presentation as well. What kind of tracking and GPS mistakes did you experience with your app? And did you produce the app for just the special system you had on your specific tablets? Or did you go in the Play Store or the Apple App Store or whatever?
No. We produced it on Unity. And we had several problems. You saw that video was done in winter. And we had a problem with the temperature and the iPad. And first what was reacting was the GPS there. Then we did it in Berlin. All the tryouts we did in Saxonia, in a little town nearby Dresden, where GPS worked very well, because it's only low houses. Then we arrived in Berlin, and we got lost. On that iPad, you have arrows that you can follow the street, and that was guiding you in Berlin in totally different directions and into the buildings. It was sometimes possible for us to fix it right at the place so that people could continue, but in most of the cases not. And after that experience in Berlin we had, we decided to skip GPS and only to do with scanning markers, and then to put it on a map and to find where are the people now. And from then on, it worked much better. We are still losing sometimes, one or the other, but we experience it has less to do with technology, more with the people, because when we explain you have to scan a marker, they don't understand us. They stand on the marker and put the iPad down. And yeah.
We have another question here.
So I would have a question to about the structure of PlayOn. Maybe I didn't totally get everything. So you have kind of many institutions that you are collaborating with since some years. Is it some sort of in a circle where there's so many ideas and projects shifting around anyway that there's already enough for you to do? Or are you still an open circle where people who may have ideas can contact you and ask you, hey, I have this great idea and it's gonna be awesome and I want support? Is this possible?
To ask for support, yes, that's possible. To join the club, not as a closed club. And the reason is that we applied for European funding. And that's why it's not flexible. It's some at that point really stupid. We are very happy to get that money, but it's stupid because you had to make a budget. You had to make your plans. We did it in 2017, and we have still to follow that right now. So that's why it's unfortunately a closed club. But good ideas are always welcome, and also question, because we have like Theater Academy in Dortmund and the universities, which are open and very collaborative.
Thanks.
Okay, then once again, a big applause for Dirk and Lucy. Thank you so much. And let's come to the last talk of the session. So hi, Niels and Roman. This time we have three speakers, and they are minus one. If I translate it. And minus.eins is a Berlin-based digital theater and arts project with a strong focus in innovative technology, interactive storytelling, and virtual production. They research, develop, and produce mixed and virtual reality theater and digital media arts. Their latest productions have been nominated for the Faust Prize and for the digital showcase of Theatertreffen in Berlin. So enjoy it. The stage is yours. Thanks.
Test now. Okay. Thanks for the introduction and for the invitation. We're happy to be here and give you a very quick overview over especially some of our latest productions, which heavily utilize both virtual production setups. I will talk a little bit about this in a few seconds, and also virtual reality setups. Maybe in the beginning, just a few words about who we are. Of course, we are part of a much bigger group. We have a big team that is collaborating with us. There are creative coders, other designers, musicians, et cetera, that usually are part of minus.eins. Today we three represent the whole group. My name is Roman. I'm a writer, director, and digital artist. I was also a founding, part of the founding group of the Academy for Theater and Digitality, because they were also mentioned as part of PlayOn, and I'm currently head of the XRT, the Extended Reality Theater in Nuremberg, together with Niels, in this case, Niels Korte, where we try to establish a stage that is solely focused on like researching and producing digital and hybrid theater performances.
And, yeah. Yeah, then I'll take over. So my name is Niels Kott. I'm also author, writer, director, and coder. And also, Roman and me, we had a fellowship at the Academy for Theater and Digitality in Dortmund, where we basically made our second project together and started our digital theater career, or whatever. And yeah, and now we have this beautiful digital stage at the State Theater in Nuremberg, where we come later for our productions. We start over there.
I'm the second Niels in the group, and I think my title is a little bit shorter. I call myself live performance 3D artist and tech artist. I don't really know if live performance 3D artist is like a thing, but I think it sounds nice. So I'm gonna keep on calling myself that.
It's funny, when working with digital theater, you just constantly come up with titles or functions that sort of like try to describe what you do, but it's never really matching. Yes, so I start the conversation about virtual production in the context of live theater production. So yes, what is virtual production? Virtual production is a sort of technology that is that became a little more prominent in the recent years in film and movie production. Niels will mention a few examples in a minute. Like, what can you do with virtual production? What is it about? It's mainly a tool that enables you to integrate live video footage, like of performers, of objects, etc., and incorporate them in real time into 3D environments. So it enables you basically to put actors, performers into virtual spaces via camera, make them interact in real time with those objects, with virtual avatars, etc. Yes, like the basic function is you have like this classical camera, and you sort of like track the position in real 3D space, and this enables you to synchronize it with a virtual camera in virtual space. And maybe you want to tell
to go a little bit more into more detail. So basically, what you see right now is an example of what we have. We have in the most basic form for virtual production, because it's such a vast term, isn't it? There's a lot of Gnomon and stuff that can go into virtual production. Just to have a baseline, you need a camera, and you need something that the digital world can come into the physical world, because in any case, there's always a portal needed, right? If you have a digital space, usually you look into a phone, or like on a projection, as we do right now, you have your head-mounted displays. In any case, you always need like a medium where the digital can meet the real world. And with virtual production kind of enables us to have just a little bit more control over both at the same time. So we have a physical camera. This physical camera, the movement, the rotation, and all of its other attributes are mimicked into digitality. Which means that if you pull out your phone and you film like an actor, in this case, it's Niels over here just pointing on, sticking some markers on the ground. But you can hold your phone to him, and the background, as we are in a green screen, can be rendered out and keyed out in real time, replaced with a digital background, and this all in a live format. And I think this is really the key factor, because keying someone out in a green screen is not new, right? Productions have done that for like, the last 40 years or something. But the key factor is really that this can happen in real time, depending on the budget of the production. If you have like an LED screen, maybe we can, famous examples is like the Mandalorian series on Disney Plus, right? They have an LED wall, which is extremely expensive. We still have, I think we have an LED wall in XRT, right? Yeah, that's something to brag about. But usually, you, in a smaller budget, you still have to work with a green screen. And now we can really marry those two together, as we briefly see here. Obviously, if you have an LED wall, lighting and everything is way more accurate. If you only work with a green screen, you still have to worry about lighting, so the immersion doesn't break and everything. But to have our baseline on which elements are needed for virtual production setup, you have your camera. You need to somehow track this camera in our into the engine that you're using. You can either use Unity or any other game engine. We love to work with Unreal Engine, so this is our software of choice. And that's basically it. And the rest is sort of just a question of budget, isn't it? So the more money you throw at it, the better it can look. But as you can see here, everything that you see can be replicated at home with a little bit of craftsmanship. But this is really a beauty of virtual production, especially in a theater context, because the creativity is really what drives the effect and what makes it happen. So in other productions I mentioned earlier, right, The Mandalorian, which is obviously a huge Disney production, there's a lot of money involved, and also Avatar 2 is another prime example of where this has been used in a broad format, in a big scale. But what can we actually do with this technology when we're talking about theater? We're talking about digital theater, virtual theater, and what are the possibilities with this setup for us?
Okay, then I want to talk a little bit about, okay, why? You know, we mentioned a little bit the setup, where it's used, but what are the reasons? What can you do with this sort of virtual production? One thing maybe in the beginning is, like, we were constantly we were working with virtual reality setups in different circumstances or for different productions, but also at the same times we tried to develop ways to show virtual spaces or hybrid spaces, also with your free, you know, just with your eyes, like without the need of a headset, because sometimes it's easier, you know, if you have a classical stage, for example, or a bigger audience. So this is also something where we decided to work on and research, besides virtual reality productions, also this sort of virtual production. What you also can do with it is you can stage algorithms. This is one of my favorite examples, but it's really, really tough to, you know, if you really want to create an experience, not only talk about it, but create a physical experience on the stage to stage algorithms. You know, what does data look like on a stage? What does data look like in interaction with a dancer or a performer? Virtual production enables us to look into this in another way. It enables us to create interactive experiences. So things that we are also try to incorporate or develop for our projects, for example, are like modes of interaction between an online audience and the live streaming environment. You know, so you can have a virtual production background, and it's because it is running in real time, so it's not pre-recorded, and the actors, performers are just reacting to a video, basically. You can also have, for example, the audience in a live chat put in commands and have them change the environment, you know, make it slower, faster, bigger, whatever, change the whole environment in real time. And it also enables us to create these sorts of basically impossible spaces, which is what we frequently do in our productions. So have sorts of liminal spaces, you know, spaces that are basically impossible in the real world, or spaces that constantly shift, that are glitchy, you know, where walls move that get bigger, smaller, etc. And last but not least, it also enables us to incorporate into pre-production. So basically, you know, especially if you have an international team, it's not necessary, or maybe it's just an addition to the classical Bauprobe, you know, where everyone is coming together in the stage for the first time, trying to figure out how to do it. So we can basically also do it way before that, online. Everyone is wearing a VR headset or just via a camera, and you can visit a virtual replica of the stage, put actors in it, put objects in it, interact with it in real time. Yeah.
And we actually do that, right? So I think we are prime example, since we are most of the time not in the same room until the end of the production, and somehow it always turns out. Designing 3D for real-time theater, I think, is also like an interesting topic to tackle, because usually you think designing a 3D stage or like designing a 3D environment is designing a 3D environment. Where's the difference to designing a 3D environment for video games or for like a theater piece? But there are different challenges and different modes that you have to consider. Because in a video game, typically, if you really take a closer look at especially doors, right, especially doors, they are huge. If you really look at a door in a video game, it's huge, because it has to be. It has to do something with the field of view that you have in a video game. If you play Modern Warfare the next time, just look at a desk. The desk is usually like at eye level. It is tremendous. But when you're playing a game, you don't care. But if you have an actor in the scene, this scene in other slides. If you have an actor in the scene, obviously you can't put in desks there that are like at eye level, because that looks really weird. And other than that, you set dress a stage differently than you set dress a video game level. But sometimes all of these things have to be present at the same time. For virtual productions, what we did, especially for a production that we're gonna tackle on a little bit later, the set did not only have to be a stage, but also like a functioning video game level, because afterwards you were going through and having some fun with the level. So all of these things you have to keep in mind. And I really love what you said before with building spaces, because I'm also a very big fan of building those TARDIS rooms, right? So TARDIS from Doctor Who, where it's just a telephone booth, and you go in and it's huge, it's vast. And I really love that when we're building digital spaces, because why use a digital space if you only replicate the real world? What's the point in it? Do something fun with it. Maybe go in a door in your basement and all of a sudden you're on top of Mount Everest. Why not? That's exactly the point. Why we use all of this digital stuff. But 3D design, or just designing, challenges in design is not only how it looks. Obviously, that's a big factor, but also we tackled a bit on interaction design and how the audience, for instance, can interact with the design and the environment itself as well. So there's a lot of scripting going on my end as well. And anyone who knows me a little bit better knows that I usually like hate programming with a burning passion. But luckily, there's blueprints from Unreal Engine, which I somehow get, and I think it's a good testament to the system that it actually works, and it's really fun for some reason. But designing a 3D level or designing like a stage in a virtual production does not only take skills for 3D designing, for the whole production pipeline, from modeling to texturing to UV editing, but also any other creative field. Sometimes we have to use video inputs, photo inputs, so you better know how to edit a video or how to edit a photo, and sometimes you need sound as well. So it's really a cool thing to participate, because in one production, especially if you're like in a theater field, usually the amount of people working in this production is not too many, right? Anyone working in theater knows budget is always tight, so you can't just hire a lot of people for each and every specific step. And this is one of the things that's really cool, in my opinion, that you have to wear so many hats in different departments that the job is never the same. You always have different requirements and different phone calls that all go with this, that all end with the same line. Niels, we have to do this. We know it's not possible, but could you figure out how to do it? And this is really what makes it fun and so engaging. It's definitely not gonna get boring.
Okay, yes. Then I'm gonna go over to give you a little bit of an impression of some of our productions that utilize to different degrees and in different combinations, either virtual reality, virtual production, or interactive storytelling. There were some earlier projects that have predecessors in some fields. For example, there have been like two online theater productions, Werther and Follower, that were live streaming projects that tried to incorporate this interactive storytelling using online platforms during a live theater performance that could be watched online and have the audience being able to interact, to communicate with the performance and the actors. A little bit later, we had a two-part production, Das Haus Point One and Das Haus Point Two, the first of which we produced at Theater Dortmund. We actually produced it and showed it in the Academy for Theater and Digitality. And the Haus Point Two was a collaboration with Ars Electronica in 2021, where we tried to use theatrical ways of storytelling, but also installation art in digital spaces. The first production I want to show you that is like in a more narrow way, working with virtual production, in this case, a green screen and a tracked camera, like in real-time tracked camera, was Pan's Lab, which we did at Staatstheater Nürnberg. It was a production that was staged during the last lockdown. So of course, it was a lot of reacting to changing circumstances. So what we basically decided to do is to create this sort of like mockumentary web series where we decided to document and stream our work at the theater, our production live, and start this sort of like an influencer community parallel to the production. And like little by little, we got sucked more and more into this narrative of a vanished artist that also used to work at the theater. And he was sort of like also coding a game where he experimented with artificial intelligence, and it get more and more uncertain if we already are inside some sort of artificial intelligence virtual environment, or if this is still part of reality. You can see some, you can get some impressions of this here. Everything was again live by the camera, so the actress could interact with the chat at every moment, for example, yes. Another production that worked with virtual production was Hinter den Zimmern. It was a production we did at Schauspiel Köln. It was again a live streaming project. We streamed on Twitch. We're really happy that actually, because sometimes we get the question, is there a large enough audience for this sort of online live streaming theater? Wasn't it just during the pandemic? But actually with our last three online live streaming productions, we could amass at about 500,000 views just for the live performances. And there were a lot more with the recorded shows. Here, it was not a web series. It was more like a theatrical live movie. So the audience could connect online. They could interact with the actors in the chat. You know, it was not a really interactive play. It was more like creating this sort of live co-presence, like in the theater. You know, you shared a space. You could, the actors could see how the audience reacted, etc. Yes, so again, we used a green screen for this and a tracked live camera. Here you can see some impressions. And we really tried to, rather than, you know, bring the digital world into the theater, we tried to go to these online communities and show them theater, you know? So we really tried to reach out to them. There was a lot of storytelling and Easter eggs for the gaming community that is very present there. So you might have heard about the Backrooms, which is this sort of online creepy pasta, like a meme story about this backrooms, like these rooms that are behind our reality. And if you're not careful, you can glitch out of our reality into this other weird and strange spaces. Yes, and maybe the very last production, here you have some stills and impression. It's a production that we're currently working on. It's called Lügen über Alice, or Lies About Alice. It's a reimagination of Alice in Wonderland, a very, very free reimagination, where we are collaborating with the Berlin Symphonic Orchestra. And what we try to do there is actually take our setup for virtual production, so what uses to be a live-tracked camera, but in this case we try to live-track light sources, and this enables us to not film virtual environments with real actors, but to project shadows of virtual avatars, objects, into the real space. So pretty much, you know, you're walking around with a light source and you can see shadows of characters, objects that are not visible in the real space, but they are only there in the, yeah, in the virtual equivalent, which again, we can do in real time. So we can have live puppetry just projected as shadows, et cetera. And this show will have its premiere on October 14 in Berlin. Yes, and so I'm happy to hand over to Niels.
Now we come to our. Kann ich meinen Laptop da hinstellen? Danke. Now we come to our new digital stage that we recently founded in at the Staatstheater Nürnberg, where we now will present like four shows each season, and this will be the first in this season. It's called Symmetry, and it'll be something like a science fiction space opera noir, completely in VR. So the whole thing will be in virtual reality, and it will be like a play, which is also a linear play. So what you usually expect when you come to theater, there will be like a linear plot where you can see actors acting. They will be motion captured and facial captured, so you can see their expressions on their avatars. But also it will be like an open world adventure game. So this means that the audience will, at a certain point of the story, jump into avatars and discover, explore the virtual reality world, the environment which Niels will build for this, on their own, in order to like solve puzzles and combination tasks to bring the plot a little bit forward. So the concept and idea of the whole thing is to have, like, for me, for the first time, a production completely in VR. And this means really completely. So we have all divisions, all actors, actresses, the whole artistic team, everybody will have a headset and will be in VR and will produce in VR. So the stage setup will be made in VR, the lighting will be made in VR, we have like the whole dancing, the choreography, everything will be in VR. So in order to do this, we set up like a very expensive system of head-mounted displays, which will come from the ceiling from our theater in order to like be safe, and everybody will have like a real AAA graphic possibility to see everything, so that we also have the possibility to minimize motion sickness and other difficulties, which I come in a minute to. And also every event will be possible to show for 12 audience members. We will have two shows each evening. And so that we will have only a few people that can see it in the State Theater in Nürnberg, but we will then, after we played it for a couple of times at State Theater in Nürnberg, also go online and show it in Neos VR, which will be the platform that we're using for this. Exactly. What is Symmetry all about? It's basically a like I said, science fiction noir space opera. Planet Earth is at its end. Most of the humanity lives in the toxic ruins of an industrial society, and there is a group of genetically superhumans living in a city above the clouds, and they are controlling the surface of Earth with humanoid androids, which actually go to or are there on Earth to hold like resistance down and keep care of everything's going like planned. And
there is a resistance group on this planet, on Earth, and they like they blow up a meat farm, which is very important for the genetically engineered superhumans. And then we have a detective from Earth who is ordered to the city above the clouds in order to solve this case. And there is a humanoid android which accompanies this detective. And this humanoid android has a very special ability. He can control intelligent machines. And this is where the audience jumps in this open world adventure part. They play these intelligent machines. So at a certain point, after the linear play stops, then all the audience finds themselves in, like, for example, a vacuum cleaning robot which is driving on the floor and has a very strange perspective, or a lot of other cool avatars. So of course, I brought some live footage for you. Here you can see like the city where all this table will take place. This is downtown Manhattan. This is our main character. And here you can see like how we are doing facial tracking and motion capturing already. And yeah, this will is live footage from how it will look afterwards in for the audience. And so NewsVR is very special. For example, this is how we code in NewsVR. This is LogicX, it's a visual scripting tool. And it's basically very cool because you can code cooperatively on things. Here you can see like a game mechanic we implemented, for example. And it's very intuitive to use. And yeah, it's a lot of fun to basically do things in VR where you can watch other people doing stuff like creating 3D objects or making the collisions, collision boards and floor maps. And yeah, this is, for example, our wardrobe, where people can like choose the avatar, the actors, they go there, choose an avatar and jump into the next scene. So yeah, this is like how this production looks for actually the people who are involved. And come on. Yeah, what we experienced so far. So we are in this production for over a year now. We are, I started to write the plot, I guess like 1 year ago. And since now we have like, built a lot of 3D levels. We developed the floor maps. We developed the game mechanics. We developed the scene switching tool for the whole thing. And yeah, we encountered so many problems and so many questions that we need to solve in order to bring this play into the theater in November this year, that I just want to take the most interesting, I guess, for you to get an impression of how it is to make a complete serial production in VR. So the first thing is that we, in the beginning, started to try out how we can design a digital stage so that it's, on the one hand side, cool for the audience to experience, and on the other hand side, how, that it's also good for the actors and actresses to feel safe in the environment. And so the first thing is keep things simple that we recognize. So we have an attention guiding system, which is basically very simple. We have a floor map which leads our audience to special places where we want them to have. And we have like general attention guiding techniques, like if there is something in neon light, then you usually look there because it's it catches your attention. Or usually people in 3D environments, they want to go up, because they have a better view on things. So we design also our levels that people can go up and there is the next clue, for example, and stuff like this. The next thing is testing. We really had to get people into the production just for testing, to have an outside eye on all these things we are going to implement. So we have these floor maps. Nobody can fall over in the open world adventure part, then he's gone and he spawns again and so on. And we had to, like, the whole game mechanic, the scene switching tool, we just need to look over and over again that it's clear that at the end everything will work. And the last thing is modularity. So we are building the whole thing that we have prefabs, that we have modules that we can exchange later on. So if we decide that we want to change something in the plot, then that we don't have to, like, basically start over again from the very, very beginning. Then the next big thing is, of course, onboarding. We all know that if we, every VR production is like, how can I get the audience to like move on their own in this environment? When someone who isn't used to VR gets first time a headset on his or her head, then it's like, oh, where am I? And so they're also make it as simple as possible. So in our world, they only can move in the four directions and they can click on stuff and that's it. whole other thing for the team. The team, of course, the actors and actresses, they need to do everything. They need to like climb, fly, make them bigger, smaller, change their perspectives, teleport them somewhere, change their costumes. In order to do that, we really need to have a training with them in front. We have 2 weeks before we start rehearsing, where we just like go together with the three actors, which will play in the piece, and show them everything. And So. The last thing is, in order to make the actors and actresses feel safe, because it's a thing if you're coming from a usual stage and you're jumping into a virtual reality, everything's kind of different. There is no, not like if you're on your regular stage and the power is off, then a stage technician comes and changes whatever light bulb. And you can keep on. And in a virtual reality, it's very easy for people to get lost because they feel unsafe, they don't know where is something. And in order to help them out with this, we have like an invisible stage manager in the virtual reality, which is the whole time there close to the actors. And if something happens, like an asset is missing, which they need to play, or if something's not working, the stage manager just can like reset the whole thing, the scene, or just bring the asset back and put it there. Nobody's seeing him or her, and we, okay. And the last thing is, what effects does the production process have on the artists and trades involved? What we recognized after starting rehearsing was like that having a complete theater production, which will be 60 minutes long, in VR means that also the actor and actresses need to spend a lot of time in VR. This means they have a headset on their head for, it weighs like, I don't know, ours right now, 2.1 kilos, and you have it on your head the whole time, and you really need to train. You can't do a long period with the headset on your head, because it just started to, your neck starts to you get pains in your neck and so on, and you also have to keep an eye on your eyes that they are not getting dry and so on. So we have regular breaks like every 45 minutes so that we can just like concentrate again and coming to an end, actually I just say some more. We just skip the realization because I already talked so much. To team and tasks, so far I have a supporting programmer, so I programmed a lot in advance in order to be sure that everything will work, and now I have support on that. We have, of course, Niels as a 3D designer, we have a stage manager and even technician who's on the board as well the whole time, and of course the whole artistic team of author, dramaturgs, we have a co-director, we have assistant directors, we have consultants who from outside who support us. And of course, we have a lot of testers. Yeah. So sustainability is the last thing. The whole production actually is what we build in this production will be like, we have a lot of prefabs and assets, the whole scene changing mechanism, the game mechanics, we all have as prefabs, so we can reuse them at any time. So I hope this will not be the last production in Neos VR, which we are using at the moment. And I would be very happy to see you all in Nuremberg when we start with our premiere on the 18th of November next year. This year. And so far to this. And if you're interested on Symmetry or Alice, which are our upcoming productions, then just scan that QR code. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you so much. Do we have any questions from the audience? Yeah.
Hello, thank you very much for your presentation. What a lot of work. It's quite mind-boggling. Can you just explain a little more about how the actors are, how their work in physical space is witnessable or visible in the virtual space in the last production?
Actually, we have so far an omnidirectional treadmill for them to stand in and move in all directions, but they stay in the same place while they are motion captured, actually. So for them, it's possible to really walk a long road somewhere. As well as we, of course, they can move via controller or, yeah. So.
So are they in the same space as the audience members?
Yeah, they are. So they are standing, they are just like separated by a stage fabric, which is falling down at the end of the show. So there will also be the possibility for applause. But they are in the same room. And we have like 12 people standing in a big part of the room. And then they are like behind a curtain and have their own place.
And sorry to ask one more question for clarification. Do they hear... How do we hear the actor through our audible, through the actual gap space between us, or through microphones and
it's very heavy stage fabric, so that's quite okay. And it's like while there is a linear play, the audience can't talk to each other, and while we have the open world adventure parts, they collaboratively have to solve these puzzles, and so they have the opportunity to talk to each other also. And we have like headphones which absorb the surrounding noise. So
noise canceling.
You can hear people standing directly beside you, but it's somehow the music which comes over your speakers is more immersive than what you hear around you.
Sorry, just to add on a clarification question. So you're saying that the setup is 12 people with VR headsets, and the actors are actually in interfaces for real with motion tracking suits? Or how is the live link from the movement of the actors into the VR world happening?
The live link?
No, there is live. So when I have headsets, mm-hmm. and the actors are acting in the VR world live. Is that right? And how is the interface? How is the transfer of the movement, the physical position, the movements happening?
Yeah, they are really moving. So the scenes are planned like they
motion they tracking suits or something.
No, it's just like it's Vive system. We use Vive trackers. We have full body tracking with it's just 5 trackers, but it's cool enough for our proposals, and this is just working.
Just the positioning, so the visual characters. Oh, you just take the position in the space of them.
When exactly.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
We have another question here. The left side, great.
I actually have another question. I guess it goes across both seeing the actor physically for a virtual production, but then also when it's an avatar. I've seen recently another production that had avatars, and I'm really interested in the way the actor's physicality actually, in the way that they perform, has to change, because I would say a failing of the recent production I saw was that I feel because the actor couldn't see themselves, how the avatar was moving, because an avatar doesn't move exactly like a human moves all the time, does it? They were using their arms loads, and so it didn't look, they looked really theatrical, you know what I mean? And I'm thinking, are they finding that this kind of new physicality is almost like a new art form in its own right, because do they have to do micro adjustments to the way they move? Because otherwise, I found it incredibly distracting, because I'm doing it now. This actor was doing this all the time, and I was like, the avatar was doing this, and it was in my face. And so I think, I just want to ask about that, your experience of that.
Probably it's a little bit different in both situations. Like for our virtual production setups, it's really usually like trying to give the actors, performers time to sort of like, getting adjusted, you know, to how the avatars move, especially if they have a different physicality than they have. And we usually really try to work on a monitoring system that gives them the possibility to see them in the most important directions very clearly, yes. But it's definitely always something to consider.
And it's always something that takes a lot of time, we recognize. So for them to really play with mocap systems and to realize what they can see, but it's amazing to like, also very interesting for the actors and actresses, because they really enjoyed it and had a lot of fun, but yeah.
Oh, just quickly to follow up, do you think that those actors then are now experts in this field in their own right, or is it something to be trained in, you see?
I guess there are experts. We have some which are helping us out. And yeah, so basically, I guess, so having a production for like 60 minutes is not very common, because it's for the audience as well. It's very difficult to have a headset for 60 minutes on a head if you don't do that on a usual base. But I guess there is already a lot of stuff on the internet where you can see like people having theater actions in computer games as well. And all those social VR environments like Neos, like Spatial IO, like Hubs, there is a lot of gaming inside as well. And people start to recognize that you can use social VR for theater purposes. And this is like where I guess the whole thing is going forward.
Okay, so a big round of applause for the speakers once again. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Grover, you want to say something?
Because we have a live stream opened, there is also a question on the live stream.
Okay, we still have a question left. Yeah. I'm sorry, I misinterpreted it.
Move around the actors to view the play from different perspectives. Will the sound also adjust depending on where they move?
Yes, there will be spatial sounds, and yes, the audience will be able to move around freely in the open world adventure parts. In the scenes, they can't because they're on a fixed position, because if we make them move, we just recognize they get motion sick, because if you follow an actor's movement, that's not cool.
Thanks for the question. We want to have a last one? So maybe, okay, the last question.
One thing I've never seen before was the virtual programming tool inside the VR space. So you are working inside the VR space to what do exactly then?
It's like a visual scripting language, like blueprints, for example, in Unreal Engine, or there's dozens of them. But the cool thing is you really, like you have each note, you can just place somewhere in 3D and you connect them with your wires like you... would in any visual scripting, but the real cool thing is you immediately see what you code. So when I, like, for example, write a variable and I can immediately see the impact on the world around me. So this is also when I start programming shader or something like that, this is cool because like you can interactively change your environment and not just seeing it from the outside, but being inside.
Well, that's amazing.
Okay. What about the second round of applause to conclude it once again? So yeah, actually not only this session is coming to an end, but also the day, right? And we had a great day. We learned a lot about how we can use immersive technologies like VR, for example, in different contexts. We learned about the advantages, but also the challenges that we still face. But you know what's super exciting? There's still one day left, right? So the expanded animation is not finished yet. So we will start tomorrow 11 a.m. with the synesthetic syntax. Then we will have panels across the day and we will have the closing keynote in the evening. So we're looking forward to seeing you tomorrow. With this, I conclude this session. I conclude this day and have a nice evening. Thank you so much.